We're keeping it simple on today's episode. I mean, really basic. We're drilling down to the most simple, probably smaller than you can possibly imagine. Whatever you're envisioning, it's smaller than that. So small, yet anything but trivial. You will say after today's show, how can something so small be so huge? Stay tuned while Steve and I harmonize the Song of the Cell. Next up on Book of the Day. It's October 27th, 2022 in Cedarburg, Wisconsin. I'm Jeff Messerman. Joining me is yet another jumble of cells, this one located in Massachusetts. And this mass of interlocking cells is known as Steve Donahue, book critic at large. Hello, Steve.
Hello, everybody.
Thank you for joining us today, as always. Let's talk about The Song of the Cell is the book.
Yes, The Song of the Cell by Siddhartha Mukherjee. Quite a few will know this author from The God of All Maladies, The Emperor of All Maladies, his book about cancer.
Right. Which comes up in this book quite a bit. Right away off of the first page, you're introduced to what he does for a living.
Yes. And he followed that up with a book called The Gene, mm-hmm. Which I'm realizing you can see directly over my shoulder. He followed it up with a book about the gene. And this one is about the cell, about the billions and billions and billions of little organisms that make up who you are.
You know, if I were Mr. Mukherjee's agent, I would say, this is all going so well. Next year's book, The Nucleus. We just keep fantastic voyaging this, don't we?
Well, this is very much, those of you who know this author's work, The Emperor of All Maladies is probably in the library system.
Right? Oh, without a doubt. Very popular.
You'll know the approach that he takes, which is oscillating, much like a cell, where he will look at the broad picture of what a cell is, how we know what a cell is, what a cell does, and then he will zoom in on specific people, researchers who've studied the history of cellular development, people who are afflicted by what happens when cells go wrong.
Absolutely.
And that happens, that oscillates in and out throughout the course of the book to just keep you reading. So no matter which kind of science writing that you like, you're going to get them both in this book, perfectly interwoven with each other.
Knowing our subject matter for the day, I tore into it last night pretty aggressively. And I didn't know you'd be turning me loose on a horror book last night. Steve, there are exhilarating moments, but I'll tell you, there are stuff in there that made me immediately worried. I mean, instantly worried.
Your doctor's going to be getting a visit. I've got a long list of things, a much longer list than usual of things that could be wrong.
I thought I was fine.
That is part of the overarching point of this book, which is that the more you look at these things, the more complex they are. The more we learn about them, the more mind-staggeringly complicated they are. And when you have that complication, that level of complication, replicated millions of times, all working in concert, things can go wrong.
Oh my goodness.
Lots of things can go wrong.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's making me regret my breakfast. I had a donut this morning. That was a terrible idea.
Well, it's really just a bunch of cells. Right? So
maybe not the best cells I could have chosen, but there they are.
a lot of our audience will remember looking at the cell in high school biology. Mm-hmm. The cell membrane and the nucleus and all of the items, all the organelles all around it and whatnot.
I gotta be.
this book is that to the 15th degree, to the 10th power of magnitude, emphasizing that these things, yes, okay, your liver is composed of millions of liver cells, but each one of those cells is an organism on its own.
Miraculous. Yeah. Truly.
We don't want to use the word miraculous after yesterday's.
Well, you know.
I know what you mean.
It's not the word, it's how you use it.
And besides, no matter, we are not trying to court controversy here in the wilds of Wisconsin, but no matter where you are, no matter who you are, no matter what you believe, you surely acknowledge that your body is made of cells.
Like it or not.
you can look at them in a microscope. So you simply cannot. There's no controversy in this book at all.
Right, right. No, there really is not. No, and then that's, I mean, the only controversy is the internal, flames that get fanned. But I will say that it's really interesting how he mentions that any cellular discovery, and that if they can hail it and say, oh, we've really had a breakthrough, along with that breakthrough comes so many other new problems. And yeah. I'd never really considered that before until looking at this book.
Actually, I probably shouldn't say, but there's nothing in the least bit controversial in this book. I want to read a passage that Please. Sort of contradicts that and then underscores what you just said. This much is undeniably true. We've thrown open the black box of the cell, here referring to the black box in the cockpit of an airplane that is famously unbreakable. To snap the lid shut now might be to foreclose the possibility of a magnificent future. To keep it jammed open without guidelines and rules would be to assume we've reached some tacit global agreement about what is permissible and impermissible in the manipulation of human reproduction and development, which assuredly we have not. We used to think about the fundamental features of ourselves as our destiny manifest. Now we are beginning to treat these properties as legitimate arenas of scientific annexation, manifest destiny.
Oh my goodness.
And that is referring to cellular manipulation in that particular instance of probably the most controversial element connected with all of this, which is what happens when you can manipulate the cellular structure of a fetus. What do you do? That quote is specifically in reference in the chapter where it occurs to being able to correct a hearing impairment in a fetus on the cellular level.
Wow. You know, I read that passage last night myself, and I kept going because I didn't want to stop because I was thinking, did he just say what I think he said? And you've just confirmed it. So, okay.
Well, it raises the question, right? The ability to detect a hearing impairment or Down syndrome or a million other things, the ability to detect those things long predated the ability to do anything about them.
Yes.
Once upon a time, the question was, for a cutting-edge scientist, for a cutting-edge obstetrician or whatever, would be to bring the parents into the office and say, I'm afraid to tell you that your child will develop X, Y, or Z. Absolutely. And maybe the choice there was, well, do we keep the pregnancy or not? And now it's even more complex because some doctors can call you into the office and say, the child will develop X, Y, or Z, and we can fix it.
Yeah.
We can change it.
Oh, my goodness. I mean, I know you're a Star Trek fan. And so Star Trek always gave us this sort of interesting glimpse into a potential future. But the potential future you're talking about and Mr. Mukherjee is talking about goes way beyond that. I mean, Roddenberry could even predict it something like this.
Or maybe we hope that it does.
Right.
Because when Star Trek mentions genetic engineering, they mention it with abhorrence.
Yes, they do.
The beings that were genetically engineered are monsters. They are figures of horror in history and in the present day.
Right.
And you have to wonder how that applies when you're reading those parts, that what I would call the proactive parts of the Song of the Cell. You have to wonder, let's say that you are, I don't even know, the examples are endless. Let's say that you are, that you have dwarfism.
Sure.
Or albinism. Or even, I don't know, left-handed.
I was just going to say, possibly even in vitro IQ test. You're like, oh, no, I want a smarter child. I mean, well, I don't want to go there, but I went there.
Composed of neurons, of neuron cells, of neural cells, which got their own chapter in this book.
Sure, sure.
You start to ask yourself, well, okay, then, if my doctors can tell me that the 8-week-old fetus that we're carrying will have Down syndrome and we can fix it, well, where do we draw the line?
Mm-hmm.
If they can change that, and what do you say to all the people out there living, being loved, living fulfilling lives with Down syndrome?
Right, right.
Go to them and say you're something that could be fixed.
Oh my.
Right, exactly.
Oh my, exactly.
And the neat one of the wonderful things about Sid Mukherjee's books is that he respects your intelligence enough not to just lay down the law. Instead, he leaves this stuff open for you to think about.
Without a doubt. And by the way, with absolutely lush prose. This was such an enjoyable. The only thing that, you know, upset me about the reading last night was that I did have to go to bed, a problem you don't have.
Your listeners are probably confused.
Well, just dial up Steve Donahue on YouTube and you'll know exactly what I'm talking about very quickly.
I'm actually from Gallifrey.
There we go.
the two hearts, the weird past, and no sleeping.
Not supposed to confirm that. I think it's a Time Lord. But anyway, wonderful. You know, and we were talking about the fact that we're dealing with a little more science-based books than we normally would on this show in this first week. But this one was so readable, and the prose was just so delicious. You really will forget you're reading a science book very quickly, I thought.
Which is, I won't preach, I promise, but that's a point that I want to make about all great nonfiction. If you are reading a work on cellular biography and you are bored, you are reading a bad work on cellular biography. It's not that the subject is bad, it's that the author is bad. You're not going to have that problem with this book.
Without a doubt, yeah. I was very grateful to have cracked open its cover last night. And our copy will be available here, I would say, within 24 hours. I'll have that processed and on the shelf. So hopefully we made you excited, you know, about nonfiction. Nonfiction November coming up for those of you YouTubers out there. And
you do have to wonder what Mukherjee's next book will be.
Where do you go from here?
I very much want him to write a book just about the brain. That would be amazing.
Just would be quite a little you know, play field for him.
The neurological sections of this book to be the most fascinating, because that's those cells combine to make us. They make your identity.
Absolutely.
And they are working and shedding and firing and recombining every second of every day in a way that quite a few other gigantic cell groups in your body are not, because they don't need to be.
Right.
It's just those cells. Those cells don't look the same as they do even in our nearest great ape ancestors. They don't look or act the same.
Sure.
And the reason that we run this planet is because of that.
The fact that we wash our hands sets us apart from so much, because the amount of cells we're scraping off and letting run down the drain, whales. We talked about whales on the show. Whales don't wash their hands, as far as I know. Their absence of hands, of course, being a huge part of that.
They don't wash their hands. It's true. They don't develop thermonuclear war either. But, you know, maybe they would if they could. Right? That classic line from The Simpsons, a cow would eat you if he could.
Absolutely. The whale's thinking, just give me the keys to NORAD. I got it from here.
there we go. One mystery that Mukherjee does not penetrate in this book is what happens if at 8 weeks there are signs that the child will become a librarian.
Whoops. That's all I got to say. Whoops.
What do you do if you're the parents? What do you do?
We had selected on the menu earning potential. Whoops. Well, back to the drawing board. Anyway, the book is The Song of the Cell, and it is wonderful. I enjoyed it. I'm going to finish it tonight, hopefully. And there we are. And the show is Book of the Day, and he is Steve Donahue, and we're lucky to have him, because you know all that reading you're not doing? He's doing it. Back tomorrow to cap the week, and we'll have a fun one tomorrow. Steve has assured me that we're gonna have a good time. So there we are. Thanks for tuning in, everybody, and thank you, Steve.
Thank you, everybody.